What's up, beautiful people? Hey, yeah. What's happening? Yeah, let's do this. The name is Jose Trujillo. I happen to be the muy macho, uno más, mucho grande, world's greatest living artist. I am driving around, man. Driving to the studio. Been doing some fun stuff already. Like waking up. I'm like, woke up, dude. I woke up, man. What's happening, people? Dude, I had a long night. My wife is like, I'm gonna let you sleep in. I'm like, baby, don't do that to me. She's like, you look so tired. She understands my je ne sais quoi. She knows what this whole je ne sais quoi is about. But yeah, anyways, guys, it's been a good day for me. What's happening, Chris? What's happening, Ken? What's happening, people? This is Jose Trujillo, baby. The world's greatest living artist. Man, I've been having some crazy dreams. They're like, no, yuck. Some of those yucky dreams, man. Ugh, no. Vaya con Dios. I don't know why. Gotta realign myself. Read some, I'm gonna read about dreams. What it means. Who knows? So anyways, guys. My wife got me my Starbucks early in the morning. It's not that early anymore. But it is early in comparison to, There we go. Comparison to other people, man. That's what's up with me, you guys. What's happening, beautiful people of the Grams? This is your homeboy, Jose Trujillo, baby. Anyways. Yeah, I got nothing right now, guys. I got nothing, man. I like when people are wearing a mask in their cars. That's a real trooper right there. I love my super maskers. I love them. Now, I ain't against the masks, but some people, you know. Some people are just funny. They're super maskers. I call them super maskers. I think people should be wearing their mask and shit and get vaccinated and all that good shit. But then I know some super maskers, you know. I got some buddies who are super maskers. So I like seeing them in the car. I think I did this in the beginning too. I'm pretty sure I did it too. You're in the car by yourself with a mask. You know, there's no one else in the car. It's just you're in the car by yourself with a mask. You know, with two syringes. Like, fuck COVID, man. Oh, man. Fear is a motherfucker, man. Fear gets you. Fear's bad. Fear is mucho malo. But it's that fine line, right? Between being afraid and being cautious. You can never be too cautious. You know? When you say you can't never be too cautious, and then there's like being paranoid. So I had a buddy who was always like, if he went to his house, he was one of those type of people that were like he had like a, you know, Arizona, he had like a rifle on top of the door, or a shotgun. I don't know what the fuck it was. I don't remember. But he had, I think it was a shotgun. And he had cameras and all kinds of things. And I'm like, and the dude wasn't like, you know, the dude worked like any regular job, like construction, you know, he did construction. And I'm like, you know, it's not like he was some sort of, you know, criminal or something, that it was, you know, playing Godfather or something. And I was like, dude, why all this thing? He's like, yo, you could never be too cautious. I'm like, man, fuck that. Sounds like you got enemies. I don't want to be around you. Sounds like you got some enemies, or you got, or you've seen one too many movies, dude. It's that fine line, right? Between, you can never be too cautious and paranoia. So anyways, what's happening, people of the Grams? People of the Grams, people of the Grams, people of the Insta, Insta, Instagrams. Dude, I voted that I'm gonna do something super stupid, super silly, man, to be famous on TikTok. I know I've been saying this for a while, but I haven't done stupid shit yet, other than like talk away. That's pretty stupid. But I'm gonna do some Instagram stupidity. Dude, did you guys see that Kyle kid, that piece of shit, start crying? I was cracking up. I was like, dude, no, he didn't. He didn't start crying. And oh my God, it was hilarious. I don't like to laugh at the misfortunes of others, but I can laugh at that motherfucker. I think I got a pass to laugh at him. Anyways. What's happening, people? Early in the morning. I'm right here in my studio. Man, I hate it when people beat me to the studio, man. There's other people here. They're not here in my studio, but there's other people that have warehouses here. And I just don't like it when they're here earlier than me. He broke down so hard, didn't he? Little murdering piece of shit. He did, huh? He's faking it. He was faking it. I thought he was crying because of remorse. People were saying that he was crying because he felt afraid for his life. I would have felt a little bit bad for him if he was crying for remorse of taking the life of people. But people get so pressed on this. I'm like, no, dude, that kid went to antagonize people. What are you doing walking around with a rifle on your neck, dude? Wrapped around your body. What are you doing walking around with a rifle wrapped around your body? You're antagonizing people. Especially in a protest. It's some piece of shit antagonizing thing. Anyone with half a brain knows that that's what it is. You're antagonizing a mob that's already pissed off. You know? And so of course something bad was gonna happen. Of course. Well, walking around brandishing a rifle, of course. But I don't think they're gonna do anything to him. Let me get my went to another town with his gun to be a fake. Yeah, it's all that bit bullshit privilege. A lot of people don't like when I talk about it, because they're like, oh, it was self-defense. It was, yeah, whatever it was, dude. You don't do that. You don't walk around with a rifle wrapped around your body antagonizing people. that already pissed off. Exactly that. He went to another, look. He went to another town. I'm going to protect my... It's like the people that go to the border with the Minutemen. All those piece of shit people. I get pressed about that because I'm an immigrant. I get pressed about that. You know? Let the government do its job. Like, why are you getting your nose in there? You're only antagonizing. Yeah, he's trying to pretend to be a playing fake cop. Anyway, well, I can only dream. I hope they put him in jail. That's what he deserves. But one can only hope. Yeah, not cool at all. Oh, he's messing with a situation that was already bad. That wasn't his job to do that. It wasn't his place. He did it because he had privilege, because he knew he could. And now he's being held accountable, but I don't really think they're holding him accountable at all. And I know people are like, oh, don't play the race card. Dude, I imagine if instead of Kyle, it would have been a black person, a black man, he would be so deep in shit right now. But it was a little Kyle. So, whoops. So he gets a pass. I hope they do the right thing, but man, that was interesting to watch yesterday. Let's see. People are probably like, Jose, why are you talking about those things right now? That's my wife. That's what my wife says. Why are you talking about those things? Look at me. I look good, man, in an art studio. Because I can. That's why. Because I can. I shouldn't. It's not good for business. That's what people say to me. It's not good for business, Jose. We live in a very crazy world right now, guys. I think... give me a second. Sorry about that, guys. Sorry about that. It was my wife calling me. Let me get my charger because I think I need to charge this phone. What's happening, people? Yeah, it's not okay to do that. Yeah, not at all. We're going to piss people off with this hot topic. Yeah, I got to drop it because then people get pissed off. I get into hot topics and then I piss people off. People have their own ways of thinking, you know. People have their own, you know, their own ideas of the world and all of that. And that's not what this channel is for. You know, people always tell me, Jose, stay away from politics. But I don't consider those things politics. I consider those things, they're intertwined with civil rights. I really do believe they're intertwined with that. Because, how fortunate, right? It happened during BLM protests. Okay, let me get a charger. Here we go. Pow. Let me get my charger. Ooh la la, baby. Yeah, if people don't buy artwork from me. If people don't buy artwork from me, the very least, I'm going to piss them off. The very least, they're going to be like, oh, man. Why is Jose talking about the trial, man? The bullshit trial. Let's see. I hope you guys can see me right here. Boom. All right, what's up, people? Let's get into some real talk now, because... I don't want to lose more followers, man. I feel like I lose followers by the second. By the second I lose followers. I lose fans.
I love how you say you run straight at the topic, no fear. You know, that's what I feel like that's what an artist ought to do, you know? Yeah, it's just us. This is how it is all the time. This is how it is. Every time I get into a topic that it's hot, people are like, yeah, I'm out. Mm. Anyways, this is how it is. Dude, us artists, dude, I'm going to take a bite out of this cheese Danish. It's like a little sugar plum Danish. Mm. What's happening? I'm gonna wave at people regardless. The ones that are here and the ones that are not here. What's happening, people? This is Jose Trujillo, the world's greatest living artist. I'm in my studio. And I'm about to get some work done. It's been pretty fun this morning. I've done a little bit of work online. It's the third week already that I've been looking for someone. I still haven't found someone yet. I think it's the third week. I've been looking for someone to come work. To come work in my studio. And I've been looking for two virtual assistants. I think the virtual assistants, I might have found them already. But, man, Americans just charge a lot of money to work online. So I posted a job for, what was it? I posted one for $15 an hour, one for $20 an hour. And then I got all these people that I charge $50 an hour, 50, 50. And I'm like, I can't pay you $50 an hour. What the fuck? You're not going to make the content for me. You're going to post it. So anyways, it's been a ride. Hmm. That's what's going on. En mi vida loca. And so we'll see. What else am I doing? I feel like I start pissing people off early in the morning. It's not my intention. I promise. I swear. My hand, my heart. Like this. Like that. So that it's artistic. When they're ready to work for $20, they'll call you back, lol. Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's just that in the States, and I think in most states, it's not even $15 an hour, the minimum wage. And I don't want to pay someone the minimum. I need to pay someone more than the minimum wage, right? For specifically for small, tedious jobs, right? Like stuff that takes me time but doesn't take me lots of thinking, lots of creativity. It just takes time, you know, repetitive little things that, you know, I do online. That's about it. Just repetitive things that I do online. I go and I look at it and I'm like, okay, what's this going to take? And then I realize, oh, this is just gonna take time. Well, can I pay someone to do it? You gotta be careful though, right? Because you can't spend all time, everything like paying people. It adds up. It adds up. Let me get a calculator. That way I can touch on a couple of things like that. Let me get a calculator. Let's see. This is something that I talk about from time to time with other artists. Let's say you're hiring someone for $20 an hour, right? They're helping you package artwork or something. They're doing it, what, 6-7 hours a day, let's say, right? Well, if you have them full time, it's gonna be 8. So let's say most people can't hire full time. Full time is trickier to hire. Because you have to provide other things, right? Not just a paycheck. Let's say you're hiring them for $20 an hour for 6 hours. That's $120 times 5. Boom, that's $600 times 4. Boom, that's $2,400 a month. Now, it's not too bad, right? $2,400 a month. It's not bad at all to get someone to help you 6 hours a day, 5 days a week. However, if you are really busy, one person, it doesn't really cut it. And 6 hours a day, if they're really working them, it would probably barely cut it. I say that any type of hiring that you do is probably going to cost more around, I would say more around $4,000, pretty much twice as that. $4,000 a month if you really include downtime. A lot of people that work, it's hard finding the right person. You're going to the turnout is pretty brutal when you're hiring people. You hire someone, you have to train them, and then it doesn't work. And then you hire someone else, you have to train them, it doesn't work, or it does work, but then they have to, you know, go back to school, or they have to go back to their home or whatever, and then the turnout is pretty miserable to go with the turnout. I've hired at least a dozen people to help me package, and we finally had Marcel. It's been the most receptive and the most responsible, and that's been very hard. It's been very hard. It's been hard to get people to work. It just is. I don't know why. You know, I have no idea why, but it's been difficult to get people to work. What's happening, Inktor? Tiago, I don't know why, guys, but I need to take another bite of my crime here. Yeah. And so, any given time, let's say, if you're not doing it all, you gotta be hiring someone, right? If you're not doing it all. And so let's say you hire someone to help you package $20 an hour, times 6 hours a day, let's say, because you're not hiring full time, right? Let's say you're 1099-ing them, they're contractors. 120, because if you hire full time, you're gonna have to set things differently in your business. You're gonna have to pay more, and you're gonna have to not necessarily pay more per hour, but you're gonna have to pay more because you have to bring in benefits and stuff. And so that's another thing to consider. When you're starting out, there's no way you can do that. If you're starting out, if you're just you, you're the artist, you're the painter, it's very sour to do that. Because everything that you make is going to go to your employee. But it doesn't mean you shouldn't pay them well, right? When you're 1099-ing them. Whatever well is for the job, right? If they're helping you bring in income. This is something that I tell people. It's different jobs for different people, man. Like, some people help me bring income. Those people, I pay them more. Like, I always tell people, hey, if you sell a painting for me online, I'll give you 30% of that. Right? If the painting is listed at $1,000 and you sell it, you get $300 automatically. that is a different job than the person that comes here and helps me move shelves, right? It's a different job than the person that cleans the warehouse. Because it requires a different skill set. People get pressed about this. They're like, no, all people should get paid the same. It's a different job, guys. It just is. It's a different job than coming here and you know. It doesn't mean that all jobs are, I think all jobs are honorable and they all should get paid well. I do believe in people should make income that can sustain them, but there are different jobs. Some people are going to help me sell paintings. That's a whole different job. It's a whole different skill set. It's a whole different skill set to go in and find buyers, art buyers. It's very different than someone who's helping me move shelves, right? And so, and by the way, the person who's helping me move shelves can learn that skill set of selling the paintings and on and on. And so, yeah, I don't want to get too much into this because, you know, people have different opinions and beliefs about this. So anyways, let's say that you're paying someone $20 an hour times 6 hours a day, boom, $120, right? $120, boom. What's up in Indiana? Times 5 equals $600 a week. It's not going to make anyone survive, guys. $600 a week. This is why I say it's so damn difficult. It's not going to make almost anybody work with you other than a student or a young person. This is why I remind artists, like, think about how you're going to do things and when you're ready to expand your studio or whatever. Co-worker Chris, teammate, yeah. It's happening. And so the person would be making $600 a week, times 4, $2,400 a month. Only a student is going to work for you for $2,400 a month, guys, in the U.S. Or someone who wants a side gig. You know, someone who wants a side hustle. But no one that's a breadwinner is going to be like, yeah, I'll go work for you for $2,400 a month. And so that's what I'm talking about. So, so let's say you have three people working, for you for $2,400 times three, that's all your income is there. $7,200, right? And I'm talking about low, right? A student, what you're going to pay a student, $20 an hour. 6 hours a day, 5 days a week. If you have three people doing that, one person is packaging, the other person, well, two people have to be packaging. One person cannot package alone. If you are busy, if you really are busy, one person's not going to cut it. You need two people packaging. You need two people pulling paintings, listing, packaging. And the other person is going to be helping you list work and market, right? Let's just say that just for the, and at the bare bottom, that's $7,200. Let's say that you're an aggressive artist. I've been through this myself, guys. Let's say that you're an aggressive artist and you are bringing in, I don't know, 30K, right? You're selling, not bringing in, but you're selling 30K a month. This is safe to say, this is what I started doing about 7 years ago, eight years ago. You're ringing it, you're selling 30K a month. Why am I talking about money, man? I'm an artist. What the hell is an artist doing this? I'm trying to share this info because I feel like other artists don't share this info with artists. Because, oh no, you're not supposed to talk about this. But I'm an immigrant. I'll do whatever the fuck I want. Let's see. So, we established that it was 7,200 for three part-time 1099 contractors, people that are helping you, quote-unquote employees. They're not your official employees, but they work for you, right? Let's see. Let's say that you have, you're bringing in 30, you're selling, right, 30K. You were able to sell one painting for $1,000 every single day for 30 days. or two paintings for $500, or four paintings for, you know, $250 each, or whatever, right? For 30 days straight. You're aggressive. You're as aggressive as they come. And you're selling 30K. If you are in any platform, if you're selling that in any platform, which is most more likely in any Cherish, Saatchi, Etsy, eBay, whatever, about 30% of that automatically gets pulled out. It's the fees. About 30% of that, boom, gets pulled out. So let's say $30,000 minus 30% of mundo. So you're left with $21,000. Okay? $21,000 is left. Out of $30,000 that you sell. Okay? You're left with $21,000. Out of those $21,000, you got to, because remember, now you're selling $30,000. You're gonna have to take away another 30%. And I'm being nice here, okay? Take away minus another 30%. Boom. Why 30%? Because that's taxes, baby. If you don't take it out, trust me, you're gonna be crying in tax season. You're gonna be crying, you're gonna crawl into a hole. That's what I do sometimes. So you're left with $4,700. Okay, that's just the, we're gonna call that eBay fees and taxes. You're left with $14,700 out of selling $30,000 of art. Man, I'm enjoying this plum Danish. And then sometimes I don't. That's where it bites me in the ass. Sometimes I just want to crawl into a hole. Because I forget about the tax man. He doesn't forget about me. Uncle Sam goes, finds me. He's a gangster, man. Uncle Sam is a gangster. $14,700 left out of $30,000 that you sold in a month. I figured this out 8 years ago, guys. It was about 8 years ago when I figured this shit out. I was like, dude, I am making moolah, man. I look like I'm making moolah, but I ain't making moolah. I ain't making shit, man. It just looked like that. And so, so I'm left with 14,700 out of those 30,000, and I've only covered taxes and platform fees. Okay, because if you're selling that much, you're probably selling it in a platform that is asking you. Hopefully you're not. Hopefully you're selling it in your own website. Hopefully you're selling it on Instagram. But 99% of artists are not doing that. They're selling it in a platform because they're trying to get the traffic of the buyer. So they're selling it on eBay or Etsy or Saatchi Art or Cherish. Saatchi Art is brutal, dude. Saatchi is brutal. Saatchi takes some... Saatchi hits you hard, man, when you sell something. And so anyways. And so I haven't taken materials and everything away from this yet. Okay? And so let's say you have three people helping you, because if you're selling $30,000, it's safe to say you're very damn busy. You're pretty damn busy. And so let's say that three people are helping you, you're paying them around $20 an hour, six hours a day, 5 days a week. Okay, this is what I figured out. I had three people helping me, right? What's happening, Eric? And so that's why I would go back and draw people, and then I would go until I found my sweet spot. So let's take, it's not 7,200. 7,200 is for three people if they're working 5 days a week. $20 an hour, somewhere around there. It could be less, it could be more. Let's say around there. Even if they're working for you for $15 an hour, if you're in some states where it's $15 an hour, like here in Arizona. It's not even $15 an hour in Arizona. It's horrible, man. People don't get paid anything. The minimum wage is not even 15, but you don't want them. You don't want to pay someone less than them. You don't want to pay someone the minimum wage. Like, they're not going to help you if you pay them the minimum wage. You got to pay them more. They're not going to do their job. They're not going to do their job because they're going to be resenting you. You got to pay them, you know? And so, yeah, you get what you pay for, exactly. Yeah. And sometimes it's about talent, though, because I've had some people that I'm like, please don't go, I'll pay you more, and they just wouldn't because they needed to go somewhere else, you know, they needed to go to another state or whatever. But sometimes you find talent. Sometimes you find talent they're not necessarily, they're looking for the opportunity not to get paid. And those people are going to go and open their own businesses and shit. They're talented. They're just talented. They're very strong. They're the people that are asking me, Jose, can I go and take the paintings for you? I know that you drive them to the post office or you drive them to the UPS, to the FedEx. Let me take that job from you. I got it. Let me put them in my car and I'll drop them off for you. That's talent. When I see that's talent, I'm like, okay. You know, because they're looking for the opportunity. Why? Because they understand that taking burden from you is the most helpful thing they can do. It's not doing their job. Doing their job, you can replace them and someone else can do their job. It's taking burden from you that it's much appreciated, right? And I'm willing to pay that person a premium. I'm willing to pay that person more. I'm willing to go above and beyond for that. But it's hard to find that. Most people don't do that. Most people just go and do their job and go home. I don't know why. Maybe they didn't learn. Maybe they didn't learn. Maybe they didn't pay attention. Maybe they're not. They don't have their finger on the pulse. I don't know. When I had other jobs, the way that I would climb up really quick is that I would take burden from my bosses. You know, I would become the runner right away, or I would try to go into spaces where they're like, man, I can't do this right now. Da, da, da. Let me go manage them. You're not ready, Jose. No, I'm going to, what is it going to take? Like, I'll learn as I'm doing it. And so that would be, you know, that would be the reason why they would start paying me more. And so, or I would have jobs where people would be like, dude, you're so much help for me. I'm going to give you one of my company trucks. I always had company trucks because of that, or company cars. Because I was so much help to them that they would give me a company car. What did that mean? That meant that I didn't have to have my own car. I didn't have to pay my own insurance, have to have my own car. Da, 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 da. Just about everywhere I worked, I had a company car. Because I would take burden away from my boss. And so my boss would be like, you don't have to pay for gas. They would give me a debit card or a credit card to pay gas. I wouldn't pay for anything. If they sent me out, I had sales jobs. They would treat me well, right? Put me in a nice hotel, not like a, you know, not like a five star, no, but in a nice hotel, right? They would take care of everything and whatnot, and as companies do when you sell and when they send you out. But I would have not had been offered those positions had I not taken burden away from the boss to begin with. And so that's something that I look for, because I know that that's talent. That's someone who wants more responsibility means you're trying to help me. You're not just doing your job. Now you're helping me push this rock, right? More responsibility. So anyways, we talked about $30,000. You're selling 30,000 bucks as an artist a month. Stupid mosquito. Minus, we said 30% from tax, 30% from fees of the platform. So minus 60%, right? You end up with 12,000 bucks, baby. $12,000, $12,000. So let's say that it's not 30 and 30. Okay, let's play it safe. I know it's 30 and 30, but we're gonna play it safe. So you sold $30,000, and now you are going to, let's say it's 50%. It's 20% tax and 30% fees. Okay, let me be friendly with you. It's not true, but let me be friendly with you. Ba-ba-ba-ba. Minus 50%, you end up with $15,000. Okay, let's say you have two people helping you only. Okay, so those two people, you're paying them $20 an hour times five, times six, I'm sorry, six hours a day. Unless they're helping you for 1 hour a day, then it's bullshit, they're not really helping you. Times six equals $120 a day, times 5 days a week, $600 a week, right? Times four, $2,400. So let's say you have two people doing that, times two, that's $4,800. So out of your $15,000, you subtract $4,800, you end up with $10,000, right? $10,200. I haven't taken away, you end up with $10,000. I haven't taken away supplies and other fees. I'm being really generous here with the numbers. Really, the number is more like $5,000, but I'm being really generous here. Let's say you're super tight and you're super careful, and so you end up with $10,000 out of selling $30,000. I'm not joking, guys. I figured this shit out almost 8 years ago as an artist, and I was like, wait a minute, I don't think we're making what we say we're making. And so out of those 10,000 bones, okay, $10,200, I'm gonna subtract $3,000 for materials. If you're selling $30,000 of art and you don't think you're spending at least $3,000 in materials, you're bananas. You end up with $7,200. Okay? $7,200. Out of $30,000 you sold, you end up with $7,200. This doesn't include where you live, if you have a family, where you eat. This doesn't include if you have a studio. It doesn't include your mortgage. None of that. This is just what you end up with. Okay? If you have a studio, let's say you're paying, I don't know, $2,000 minimum for a 1,000-square-foot studio or something like that. Any city, no, they're going to charge you somewhere around that. Just for $1,000, 1,000-square-foot, sorry. Minus $2,000, you end up with $5,200. And you haven't covered your mortgage, your food, your car, your phone. You end up with $5,200. Reality check. And so let's say you say, no. I don't want to have people helping me. I can do it all by myself. Then your prices have to be very high up, and you have to have a really cool gig for that to happen. And excuse me, even if that happens, you can't. I've never met an artist that's doing it alone. I've never even heard of an artist that's doing it alone. I won't even get into that. It's just ludicrous. Just packaging one painting is going to take you half a day. If you're selling a painting for $10,000 or more, because you're like, no, I'm doing this on my own, I have high prices and whatnot, it's going to take you all day just to package a painting and create it. Right? Let's say you're paying someone to create it, a handyman or whatever. It just goes. The time flies. You're going to go to Home Depot, get stuff, or you're going to try to... It's bananas. I've tried to figure things out on that area too. No matter where you lean, it's just as difficult. So what I figured out was... This is something that I figured out. I'm not trying to be negative here, guys. I'm trying to shine some light onto what people don't share with you. Other artists out there will not share this shit with you because they're not even aware. Most artists out there are not even aware that the reason why I was able to to start moving a little faster than the average artist is because I had Lisette with me. Lisette wasn't charging me. She's my spouse, right? She wasn't saying, oh, pay me. She's my spouse. So whatever I was bringing in with her, it was for the home, right? It was for our expenses and our life. And so that alleviated. Another thing to say here is Lizette and I were willing to work 16-hour days. Wink, wink. So Lizette was doing the job of two or three people easily. Still does, right? This is the thing when people say, man, I'm going to do it myself. You got to take into consideration what myself is, what I'm going to do it myself means. Because Lizette and I have worked two shifts here in our gig for over 10 years now. Two shifts, you know. This means years without vacations. This meant, you know, all kinds of things. This meant sleepless nights, fights, right? Fights around this, like, because it's heavy. It's hard. It's hard. It challenges your marriage. It challenges your partnerships because it's hard. It's very hard. And so you learn, right? You learn as you go. You learn as you go. And so I'm trying to shine some light here on what I think most artists are not shining. They're not telling you this. That if you sell about 30K of art once everything's paid and said and done, you are, if you're very, very, very conservative with your numbers and everything, you're going to be getting about 10K of that. You know, if you work very hard and you're very conservative with the numbers and whatnot, you're going to be keeping about 10K of that for your expenses. And I just did a reality check here. I really believe the numbers more like 7K, 5K. But once everything is said and done, of course, it leaves very little for anything else. Because what you sell is not what you keep, you know? And so that's the thing. So in my head, right, in my cabeza, I was like, let's see. Deanna says, one thing you did right for sure is having only one kid from a woman perspective. Well, yeah, no, I you know, Lizette, at some point, she was telling me I it'd be nice to have another kid. But honestly, I grew up in a family with a lot of kids, and I'm like, I don't want that. Because I grew up in a family of 10, okay? Most of them were lacking. Most of them were lacking. Most of us were lacking. If you didn't lack shoes, you lacked a Christmas gift. If you didn't lack that, you lacked a bike. Everybody in my family has sad stories about lacking, including myself. So, what a burden on my parents. Nobody forced them to have so many kids, but that's the way they thought. They were super religious, and my mom, right? Didn't believe in in any form of birth control or anything like that. And so, you know, had a bunch of kids. Boom, 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 boom. and I was like, no, I don't want that. Maybe one, maybe two, but one is fine. And so it's just kind of my vision from, and I can spoil the little punk, right? That's what I thought. Like, I have one. I might be able to take care of him and maybe even spoil him a little bit. Then if I have two or three, it's gonna be a lot harder. I have a friend who has like six of them, and I'm like, dude, shit, this shit looks hard, man. You know. Let's see, lacking can be fine. if you are given everything, you don't learn to earn it. Yeah, I mean, I think it depends what type of lack, right? It depends what type of lack. The lack that I experienced in Mexico where we were growing up, it wasn't a lack that I'm like, oh, this taught me better. It was more of a lack of like, I want to run away from this as fast as I can. It was a different type of lack. So I get it, like you know, middle class Americans here that say, man, you know, I put my money together to buy my car. That's nice, right? That type of lack I do respect. Like, yeah, but there's a lack that you don't wish on your enemies. There's a different type of lack. And I know, I'm sure some people here have experienced that type of lack. I don't, the type of lack that there's not even toilet paper, the type of lack that there is, you're not sure if there's going to be dinner, that type of lack. I don't, you know, the type of lack I didn't go through this one. My older siblings did. Not having basics is different. Yeah. They didn't have shoes. They had to wear sandals to go to school. That type of lack is and sandals that had a string, right, to wrap around. That type of lack is like, ah, oh, no, you don't want that lack. Yeah. Yeah. But I get it. Yeah, I get it too. Yeah, the type of lack where you're like, man, I want a better job, or I want, you know. I think that's good, and it forces people to appreciate and want things. A Band-Aid, I love that. And so, what am I saying here? Let's see. Let's see. So out of like $30,000 that you're selling as an artist, you're pretty lucky if you end up with like $10K, right? Extremely lucky. You end up after you pay the gangster, Uncle Sam the gangster. You pay him his dues, and you pay the other gangster, the platform, right? The platform's gonna ask you for their share. And so there it is. So I was thinking, like, how can I remove that? Like, how can, if I had a chance to remove that, what would it be? Mira the mother. If I had a chance to remove that, yeah, there's some shitty ass lacking that I look back and I'm like, nah. Let's see. So let's say you sell $30,000 now, right? Just for the same number. Just so we can stay on the same number. Let's say now you're selling $30,000 and you're like, I'm gonna remove everything else, but I'm not gonna have the burden of the, what do you call it? The Uncle Sam on this end, right? On this end. You're still gonna have Uncle Sam, but on your end. I don't know if that makes any sense. But what we're gonna remove, from my perspective, what I'm trying to remove here is employees. Okay, I'm trying to remove employees and all of that, and I'm trying to remove the fees, right? So if I can remove the employees and the fees, and to me, in my mind, in my little mind, that's like, okay, employees, we said what, $4,800? So I'm gonna remove that. And I'm gonna remove the fees. Let's say the fees are 30%. And so minus 30%. Boom. What is it? $7,000. No, $8,000, because it's 21. Nope, I'm lying. Man, my math is horrible. It's $9,000. $9,000. So it's $9,000, right? $9,000. And then the other one. Dude, I gotta get back to you, man. What's happening? AD2A, a different type of art. I've been meaning to get back to you. I apologize for that. I'm getting back to you after this live. Thank you for reminding me. Get Uncle Sam and the Queen. Oh man. So it's 9,000 bucks in fees. Let's say you're selling 30K on Etsy or eBay or whatever. It's 9,000 bucks of fees automatically. Fees for the platform. I'm trying to remove that. Of course, I'm gonna charge my own fees, right? But I'm trying to remove that. And I'm trying to remove the whole employee thing. The whole, I have to, and it's not just the employee thing, it's the time, right? It's the time. Because now you don't have to get back to writing emails and getting back to clients and going and buying materials. I didn't account for materials, for shipping materials, by the way. I don't know if this makes any sense. Shipping materials alone is ridiculous. Shipping materials are so expensive. So anyways, I'm not trying to convince anybody that if they go with me, it's the best thing to do. No, I'm trying to shine some light onto what the costs are. And I think that people should do it themselves. And if they feel like, I'm going to go and try to see if Jose can sell my work via the eBay auction, I'm going to try with him. But I think people should test to see what's more convenient for them. What I'm trying to remove is all the hustle. Okay, it's all the hassle. It's not hustle, the hassle. I'm trying to remove all the hassle of dealing with clients and dealing with packaging and shipping and all of that. I'm trying to remove all that part. And also marketing the work. Right, marketing it on the platform, which is listing it and getting people to see it. I'm trying to remove that from artists. It might not be a gig that people want. It might be a gig. I don't know. Only time will tell. And it's worked for me. When I think about it, I'm like, I would. So here's something that I have thought about. Right, I would be more than happy to give Ebith 50%, because that's what Ebith charges. Ebith charges you 50% of the sale under 500 bucks. So you sold something, if you auction something with them under 500 bucks, they charge you 50%, and I understand why they do it. That's why I'm charging 50%, because I understand what it is. And they're huge. They could probably charge less, but I don't know. That's the way they worked out the numbers. So if you sold something for $500 on Ebith, you're keeping $250, and they're keeping $250. You don't have to do this, right? Nobody has to do this, but I would give that to Ebith if they gave me, if it was proven that I could sell the work, first of all, which I can, right? But also, if they let me sell artwork every single day, multiples. If the turnaround was quick, the turnaround is not very quick. And so if I send something to Ebith to sell some of my artwork, they stay with it for a while and they decide when they're gonna auction it because they have so many other items and they wanna keep it small what they are able to auction because they believe in that. They have this belief that if you don't saturate the market, there is more, there's gonna be more. Man, I look good today, look at this, man. There is more, there's a better chance of getting a higher price point at auction if they have limited quantity of artwork in general. And I don't believe that, but they believe that. I know that they have more experience in selling, you know, I know that they have more experience in selling just things, because they sell all kinds of things, not just art. But I have a shitload of experience selling artwork, and so I don't believe it, because I've gotten hundreds of pieces auctioned in a single week. As a matter of fact, the more I auction, the happier people are. So I don't see, the higher the price points go to. That's another thing that, wink, wink, people don't know out there. A lot of people don't know this. That's why a lot of artists go and try to auction a lot. They've heard me say this, or they've seen me do it. But the problem that a lot of artists do, the problem that they have, is that they go try to auction a lot with it's gotta be a balanced thing. It's gotta be a balanced thing. Yeah, you can go fast, but you gotta be able to keep a balance. You know, you can't go fast, bumpy, because it's not gonna work. And so what I mean by this is that artists say, I'm just gonna paint whatever, I'm just gonna throw shit into the fire, and it's gonna sell. It will sell probably, but you're gonna start getting those $5 prices. I don't want that. The paintings have to be well done. That's why I take the time that I take with the paintings. Although I've been painting for over 20 years and I have that experience, I don't take less than 25, 30 minutes for a painting. I don't. Because I know what that does to the price. I already know. I've seen it. I've experienced it hundreds of times. It's going to cost the painting to go for nothing. Even if people like and trust me already. If that makes any sense. So people are not just buying my signature yet. They're buying the painting still. They're still buying the painting. At some point, people might buy the signature, but that's not what they're buying. They're buying the painting. And so, and even if they're buying the signature, I don't want to cheat anybody. I don't want to water down anything. I want to give them my very best work. And I think you should too. You know, I know shoot is a no-no word, but I think it's important. It's important for your overall value of your brand and your work. So, anyways, I gotten into a completely different topic here. I think it's a pretty cool topic. Dude, this Chis Danish is the shit, man. What's happening, people? Mayor says that's why I follow you. Thank you. José, aprendemos muchísimo contigo. Muchas gracias. Muchas gracias, Mao. Great session. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Chris. So that's why I try to do this talks and this little, you know, this little lives, because I know that this shit's not being shared out there. You go and you talk to artists, nobody's sharing this stuff. Most artists don't even know don't even know they're broke. They're like, yeah, I'm monetizing. You know, we don't know that because we're not business people. We're just people that are creating artwork and whatnot. And I'm realizing what it actually takes. After a few years, you start realizing, no, there is profit, there is income. And you have to understand what those numbers are, right? You have to understand what those numbers are and what you want too, because not everybody wants to make millions, not everybody wants to make hundreds of thousands. Who sets the prices of the paintings on Saatchi, etc.? You do. The artist does. The artist does. So that's what's cool about those places. So one of the recommendations that I have for artists is, if you're going to put anything on Etsy, Saatchi Art, Chairish, I say have two different price points. That's what I say. Have something very, very high up, and have something not very low, but have something that doesn't force so much for people to buy. That it's not very difficult. That it's more like a, it's not an impulse buy, but it's an easier buy. So I would say, if I would start this over again, and which I'm doing it, right, with the new paintings that I'm creating and everything that I'm doing now, I wouldn't put anything on Saatchi for under 5,000 bucks. Me personally, I wouldn't put anything under $5,000. If I put something under $5,000, it would be a bunch of $500 drawings, you know, drawings or $1,000 drawings. Because they're going to take 30%, at the very least, they're going to take 30%, and Uncle Sam's going to take another 30% of that, guys. And so, yeah, because you're talking about city and state. You're talking, yeah, taxes at the end of the day, if you're making over six figures selling artwork, it's going to be 40% at the end of the day. But I'm being generous here and I'm saying 30%. Because again, we don't tax the rich. So the rest of us are carrying the load, where the rest of us are paying more. We don't tax the super wealthy. So everyone else who is quote unquote middle class is carrying the load of that. And so it's going to be 30% for taxes, 30% to the platform. So if you sold $100,000 of art, you end up with a whopping $40,000, and you have to take away your expenses and your life from that, right? Your rent, your expenses, like your shipping materials and your art supplies. You have to take that. If you have a helper, an assistant, boom, you have to take away from that too. If you have a serious assistant, right, and you sold $100,000 and already 60% of that goes to taxes and to the platform that is allowing you to sell that. That's not even a gallery, because the gallery is going to take 50%. Okay, so a gallery has to be higher. That's why the price points in galleries and brick and mortar galleries are much higher, because they take 50% at the very least. Someone take 60 or 70%. So the prices have to be. You have to price well, but on Saatchi art, it's about 30%. And so, anyways, they take 60% from that. If you end up with $40,000, let's say you sold $100,000 on Saatchi art at the end of the year, you end up with $40,000. If you have a real assistant, that like someone who actually helps you package and creates your work and everything, so that you're left to painting, you're gonna have to pay that person at least $30,000. I'm talking about on the low end at the end of the year. So you end up with a whopping $10,000. You can't, most people can't even survive with that in a month, you know, in the US, much less in a year. And so that's why I say don't price anything low. Don't price anything low unless you have something where you can price low that it doesn't take you time to create. It takes your skill, but not your time. So what do I mean by skill and not time? Well, you've been practicing that for the past 5 years or so, and you're really good at it. So you've got skill and you can do it in 5 minutes or 10 minutes. That's skill, right? If you can do it in a few minutes, price it at about $500 or $1,000. But why? Because it took you time to do it. It's kind of like when you go to a doctor and they check you and then they send you a, you know, or a lawyer or someone, and like, oh my God, you only saw me for 5 minutes. Why is it $7,000? Because they went to medical school, and you know, and that's just what it is. You know, I'm not even getting into the insurance policies, but they went to medical school. So you didn't, dude. So they checked you and that's what it is. They went to law school. You didn't. They are able to review that contract or whatever, and you owe them $1,000 for them to read it for 5 minutes. It is what it is. Like, people are like, oh no, they just spent 5 minutes with it. Yeah, dude, but it's 5 minutes that if they didn't spend 5 minutes on that with their skill, you'd be worried. So you're not paying for the time, you're paying for the skill. You're paying for the skill. And so artists, I highly encourage you, charge for your skill. Don't charge for time. Do not charge for time. Charge for skill. You can have price points where you charge for skill, for time. My auctions are a mixture of time and skill. You can have price points where you do that. You charge for time. But have price points where you only charge for skill. He's got brand management for sure. An experienced leader is priceless. And the artist pays for shipping. The artist... No, the artist doesn't pay for shipping on Saatchi. Saatchi, I don't think that... No, they don't. They send you a shipping label. Yeah. And so you print it out of your studio. And they actually pick it up. So that is a plus. Saatchi picks it up. They send you a shipping label and they pick it up. They send you the truck. That's always a plus with Saatchi. Yeah. And so that is something that I love about Saatchi. The thing that I don't love about Saatchi is things kind of sit there. You know? Like any other platform. But you pay for shipping materials. Yeah, you got to pay for your shipping materials. You got to do your shipping materials. So the benefit of selling your work in platforms is that you can sell it at higher price points and you get to keep more than half. Right? That's the benefit. And I recommend everyone do that. Everyone go sell it in a platform. The problem with that is that you're competing with everyone else. You're pushing and grinding, right? Because everyone is doing it too. The other problem with that, other than the competition, imagine if you were the only portrait artist in Saatchi. You've had zero competition, right? That's La La Land. And so the other problem with that is that just because you post it doesn't mean you're selling it. So that's why I love the auction so much. Because the auction, when you post it, right, 5 days, 1 day later, whatever you run the auction, I run my auctions for 10 days, it's going to sell, right? And if it's not going to sell, the auction's going to end. But the likelihood of it selling, it's pretty high. It's going to sell, especially if the art is worth anything, right? It might be worth $5, but if it's worth anything, it's going to sell. By the way, if someone pays $5 for it, they think it's worth more than $5. That's why they pay $5 for it. With anything, if you pay $5 for a coffee, to you it's worth more than $5. Otherwise, you would never let go of your $5 for it. And when you pay for something, right, it's worth more to you than what you're giving up. What if it sells for a dollar over and over? What I say, if it sells for a dollar over and over, go back to the drawing board. What's probably happening is the skill is not there yet, or the painting is not worked on yet. So two things happen when I've seen that. I've experienced that myself. You're either painting it too fast, okay, or the skill set's not there yet. In which case, don't put them at auction yet. Go keep putting them on at buy it now prices. The artists that have gotten away with putting them at a dollar, basically going and the artists that I know, after I mentioned this, that have gotten away with putting it at a dollar and selling them and getting some money for them, are basically just copying my work. They're copying. They're just copying my system, and it works for them. Because they already know it works for him. So if I do something similar to what Jose is doing, it's going to work for me. And it works also. It also works for them. They don't yield the same prices, but it works, right? It works for them. And the reason why they don't yield the same price, I don't think it's just because the artwork is not as good. No, it's because I've been doing it for longer. And so I think more people are visiting my site or my shop. That's really what I think overall. Because auctions are such a hit or miss. It just depends on who saw them and who didn't. But the stickability power is that the work, you either work on the work for at least an hour or so. If you have some skill. If you don't have any skill, you have to work a little bit more than that. But if you either have to have skill or you have to work on it. So if you don't have that much skill, let's say that I love painting, but my skill's not there yet. Then you have to put more time painting it. And so I hope that this makes any sense. Yeah. People are able to tell. I get messages all the time saying such and such is making a knockoff of your painting, and you know, it's a sign that I'm going high. I'm going to high places. It rubbed me the wrong way. I made a few videos about it, but I'm making peace with it because it's a sign that I'm reaching higher grounds. let's see. That opens up new markets too. Yeah. There's a guild in the UK. Yeah. Your hair is especially fetching today. I know, it's all over the place. Look. I'm gonna make it muy guapo look. Ooh, muy guapo, yeah. What else? I don't know, guys. I think that's all the greats are copying. Yeah. Yeah. If someone's copying your work, guys, just know you are you're going up. You're going up. Wolverine. Somebody's copying your work, you're going up. That's all it means. Don't focus on it. Don't be upset if you want to. Make a few lives. I was like, this stinky people copying my work. Because, you know, again, the reason I got upset, it's not because they went and copied a painting. They're copying the entire fucking system. And every painting that I paint, they just kind of twist it a little bit. You know, it's like Jose painted the flowers like this. I'm going to do it like this. And so I'm like, but whatever, right? It's a sign that I'm doing something good. If people want to do what I'm doing, and they wanna do it exactly as I'm doing it, it's a sign, right? It's a sign that I'm doing something right. And so, people are influenced. Imagine if you made a how-to video. Well, there would be thousands. Yeah, well, I made how-to videos. I am sure that there are thousands, in one way or another. I don't think there's thousands, but I found dozens. I found about 40 different artists who are making a living making knockoffs of my paintings. And not, they don't go and make a knockoff of my painting and then they visit Chris and make a knockoff of Chris's paintings. That's not what they do. They solely make knockoffs only of my paintings. Like they just, Jose painted a bird. I'm gonna do the same bird. Jose painted a bird on a pear. I'm gonna go paint a bird that's sitting on a pear. Jose painted, you know, you get it, right? It's the same painting. Just, they're just twisting it like that. They're like, you can't see me, Jose, but I know who you are, guys. I don't care. Whatever. You're making me famous. I know. I honestly think it's super annoying. So do I, but you know, my wife is like, Jose, let it go, dude. It's a sign, man. It's a sign that you're getting somewhere. Chris says, I see dozens for sure. Yeah. Yeah, but again, it's a sign, guys, that we're doing good things and that it means something. You know, it means something. That what you're doing means some. It's a new stage for me. It's a new stage as an artist. It's a new stage. It's an annoying one, but it's a new one. Just like when I went online. When I went on lives, it was a new stage for me because now I became the artist who showed up on lives, you know, and it was annoying for me in the beginning because is my hair good? Are my teeth white enough? You know, do I need to lose some weight, man, because I don't look so good on camera. And what am I going to talk about? It's a new stage. And so being an artist on social media, totally a new stage in my career, a new place, right? Being copied consistently and persistently, you know, quite frankly, I'm happy that they're making a living doing it, because I think that it shows that what I'm doing is worth it. So So it's a new stage. It's a frustrating one. It's pretty frustrating, but it's a new one. And I got to get accustomed to that. I'm becoming more accustomed to it. Because as my wife said, dude, the bigger name you make, the more people are going to copy you. You got to get used to it. And we talked about it. You know, you can't spend energy on that. You're going to get used to it. Just like when I started doing lives or YouTube videos, I started getting lots of hate, lots of very annoying, very frustrating, you know, racist jokes, jokes about being overweight, jokes about being very fucking handsome. Yeah, I got jokes about being handsome. New levels, new devils. Yeah, my problem with them is that they butcher your style. Yeah, that's for sure. You not only share your art, but also your great attitude in life, great values and mindset, Jose. Y tu pelo es hoy fabuloso. Muchas gracias, I love that. I tried painting a hummingbird like you, digitally experiment. I didn't use oil. No, I should share it with you just for a laugh. Yeah, no, look guys, I don't get upset. And it's not frustrating to me because I've taught this stuff. I've made videos to teach people. That's what I'm doing, right? It's not frustrating when people say, look, Jose, I painted right next to you your painting that you did. That's what it's for, right? That never has upset me or frustrated me. Or even when people go and like, I painted this, I'm going to go try to sell it. Can I sell it, Jose? Sure, whatever, go sell it. Like, that's how I started. I look at someone else's painting and I'm like, I gotta do something like that. The frustrating part became when they were trying to replicate me and they just focused on my work. That's not because it felt like I had a leech on me. I was like, get off of me. That's what it felt like. And that was the frustrating part. Yeah. Let's see, Deanna says, if you want to copy, at least do it right. They make it so ugly and muddy. Yeah, they get sloppy about it. Cause, you know, again, but this is again, right? If people want to learn, I think they should go and look at other work. That's just about every artist does that. Just word of advice for artists out there. You're going to frustrate an artist every now and then if you just concentrate on them, right? If you're like, I'm going to suck everything from this one artist and I'm gonna basically mimic everything about this artist, you're gonna frustrate an artist because artists work really hard to try to be unique. You might not. There might be better people out there in the world than me. I am butchering, yeah. Yeah. But you know, it's part of the journey. And I'm on this new part of the journey, so it's just kind of what it is, and where it hurts, it's not when they're copying you. Where it hurts is when you're reading comments and then they say, "You have such a great style," right? When other people are telling them that they have such a great style, and you know that all they did is went and copied my style. That's where it hurts. That's where it's like. That's where it stings me. I'm going through Facebook or Instagram and people are like, you have such a great style. And I'm like, it's my fucking style. I'm so petty, huh? Anyways, I hope that, this video was funny at least. And we're able to cover some stuff, you know. We were able to cover some of the things that, again, that we as artists encounter and we as artists work through. And I really wish everyone the best. You know, I'm gonna be like one of those influencers that's like, the universe is in my favor. I wish everyone the best. Let me do my artistic fingers. And we're all one, and inside I'm like, no, I really do wish everyone the best, honestly. And I think there's room for everybody. There's room for all of us. And there's stages, right? There's stages. Those artists might be in a stage where they feel they have to copy another artist, and that's fine. And I'm in a stage where it rubs me the wrong way when artists are copying me, and that's fine. I gotta grow out of it. If I want to be better, I have to grow out of it. If they want to be better, they're gonna have to grow out of it. And at the end of the day, that's our job. We need to grow out of things. Lucky you, in a good mood. Your fave artist knocked off your live this morning. Exactly. Oh my God. Yeah. Well, that's exactly what happens. So, we'll leave it there. I think that's about it. Gracias, eres un ser humano que se da cuenta de su valía con humildad. Puro amor, José. Muchísimas gracias. Te lo agradezco mucho. Mawa Collection. Muchas gracias. Un fuerte abrazo. Thank you, everybody. Hugs and kisses and kisses and hugs. X and O's. X's and O's. And X's and O's, right? Little X, big X. That's what I love about Nacho, dude. When he says little X, big X, little O, little X, little X. Let's see. Great session, Kat. New levels. It's all good. Yeah, it's just new levels. It's new levels. It's ultimately, that's what it means. It means growth. You know, when something bothers you, it's growth. It means that you don't fit in the shell anymore. We're like those what are they? Are they crabs or what are they? Snails. You have to go change you have to get into a bigger shell. Change of skin, right? And so when this bothers, when anything bothers you, it's time for a new shell. And that's what it's meaning for me. And I record this journey. I talk about this journey because that's what we do. It's a hermit crab. There you go. Thank you so much, hermit crab. As artists, that's what we do. Things get tight. I don't like this. It's time for a new one. I gotta go and get into a new shell and experience a whole other level of growth. Free advertising. Yeah. At the very least, they're at the very least, other people are doing you a favor. They're advertising you. Yeah, absolutely. So there it is. If you want to move to the next level, guys, be ready. You will be copied. You will be plagiarized. You will be and it might sting a little, but it's a sign that you're taking off, and that's the growth. That is the growth right there. So keep doing it. Again, I did some numbers for you guys, for those of you who are earning income as artists. Mira says no. it's the ultimate. It's the sacrifice you need to pay. It's the sacrifice you need to pay. If you want to get known, you will experience being plagiarized. It is a fact. It is a fact of being known. And artists don't like that. I know we don't like that, but that is the experience. That is what I've been experiencing. And I think it means it's going to get really good. I think that's what it means. It just stings in the way. It stings a little on the way there. Yeah, I did some numbers for artists. I did some numbers, and what else? Hopefully I shone some light on that. For those of you who are creating artwork and are trying to make a living creating artwork, watch this again. It might be helpful. Get out there, raise your prices is something that I'm doing. Of course I can raise a price on an auction. because they're that's an option. But do go and raise your prices. Numbers, yeah, I did a couple of little numbers on making a living as an artist and what does it mean after you pay the piper, what's left to you, realistically, right? Because I said this because a lot of artists are saying, oh my God, I'm doing all this money selling artwork, and the reality is that it's not really like that. You're selling a lot, or you're selling, I don't see you on Saatchi. I am on Saatchi. Just type in my name, Jose Trujillo. I sold some stuff on Saatchi. I've sold some stuff there. It's not very common to sell stuff on Saatchi. Not for me, anyways. But when I sell something, I get happy because the price points are higher. So it's like, oh, cool. Is the name the same? Yeah, Jose Trujillo. Yeah, I'll send you a link if you can't find me because these fuckers might have ghosted me. Anyways, I'll leave you guys with that. The name is Jose Trujillo. I'm an artist. Hopefully, I'm able to shine some light on this and keep going, guys. Keep moving. I'm going to go and paint something, and I'll record some in a little bit. All right. Peace out. Adiós.